Yes, I do also sing and I also write music, and I got to contribute to the music in the film, which was amazing. Yeah, it felt very divine.
Guys, congrats on this film. It is so sweet. Thank you. Soulful. I really, really dug it. You guys are wonderful in it. Kiki, let's start with you. I'm a fanboy if Beale Street Could Talk. That's when we first met. I followed the trajectory of your career, Old Guard. Don't worry, darling. I did not know that you could also sing your ass off. So this was like a revelation for me. I think it's going to be for a lot of audiences. Tell us a little bit about like what your musical background is and how exciting it was to tap into for this role.
Yeah, honestly, I always wanted to be a singer and an actress when I was growing up. And when I was 7 years old, I auditioned for the performing arts school in Cincinnati, Ohio, as I am also from Cincinnati, Ohio. And I didn't get into vocal music. And that was kind of the first moment where I was like, oh, maybe singing isn't my thing. Maybe I should focus more on acting. And so it's just been a very long journey since then of reconnecting to my voice and finding pride in my voice again. And this film really allowed me to do that.
Thomas, how did you respond the first time you heard Kiki sing? Did you know this? Did you know about her background?
I didn't know. So I had a Zoom call with Kiki and we had like this, you know, like meeting each other, congrats on the job and all the rest of it. And she had explained that this is an amazing opportunity for me to kind of like show the world like another side of me, another part of my passion. And I wasn't excited. Anyway, so when we kind of got together to rehearse, I was like, oh, gotta step up my game.
Well, we have seen you flex your musicality in projects before, but never do like I don't think like a music based theme like this. What did you like about getting to play a musician, getting to tap into that duality in this project?
Oh, it was amazing. It was fantastic. Like, so I went to college. I did musical theater, and I always feel like musical theater is just the pinnacle of everything. I know millions of people disagree with me, but I just think the culmination of singing, dancing, and acting all in one expression is so, so powerful if it's done well. And so, I mean, to have the opportunity to sing and to learn and play an instrument and to do it alongside someone like Kiki, it was just incredible. And we also worked with the band a lot, Brother Elsie, and yeah, it was incredible. It was amazing. And it's an amazing expression. I love being able to, that's what we do is, I hate myself, but artists express in different mediums and yeah, singing and musicality is a major one and a very powerful one, I feel like.
Kiki, you play a singer-songwriter who's kind of like at the end of the road, that sort of fork in the road where the artists sometimes reach, where you know they don't know if it's time, if they can put any more of themselves into it. But first, I want to talk about the locale, because as you mentioned, you are from the Natty also.
Yes, I am.
Natty Hooday. Represent.
Bengals.
Was this homecoming sort of coincidental? Did you know the filmmaker? Did you guys go to high school together? Like, how were you drawn back to your hometown for this?
No, Nicole reached out and I read the script and thought it was amazing and got excited about the opportunity to tell this story and finally share my singing voice. And I think it honestly was so divine that it brought me back home, because I mean, that's where all of my dreams started. And so, like I said, growing up, I knew I wanted to be a singer and an actress, and then just moved, you know, on to focusing more on acting. So I thought it was very divine to be like called back home in order to kind of kick off this part of my career where people will know that, yes, I do also sing and I also write music, and I got to contribute to the music in the film, which was amazing. Yeah, it felt very divine.
Thomas, you are not from Cincinnati. North South Dakota.
How did you know?
I gave it away.
Yeah. Thomas, what do you like about discovering these towns like Cincinnati that, you know, are what they call flyover cities or whatever?
They're nice
off the beaten path. You know, what was your experience? What was your experience in Middle America?
It's honest, like, really, I don't want to like make different parts of America sound like some kind of like. Not a caricature, but like truly when I was in South Dakota, when we were in Kentucky, it was really, it was like a film. Like you need to remember, like I'm from Scotland. Like I've like my impression of America in these parts of America is entirely based on honestly cartoons and films.
Oh no.
Right.
That's
and
really
so like
bad.
When I'm like in Kentucky, and like a train is just going through the town.
Uh-huh.
Like it was, I don't know. It was very, very surreal to be in like these places, and it was really, really cool. And I really did love it. I love Covington.
He loves the Cincinnati chili. He loves the Bengals.
I love the Bengals. Not sure about the orange color, but like, I'll come around to it.
What do you guys think are the gold standards for like music movies? Like what does Dandelion sort of aspire to be in the company of? What are your favorite films about music?
I think Once.
Once is a good that's a good one.
Honestly, the first film that popped in my head was Selena, because I love Selena.
Okay.
Neither here nor there. Selena, you haven't seen Selena? Thomas. Okay, we'll talk about this later. Well, I think that Dandelion stands out, though, like among music films, because it's really a songwriter's film. And I don't think we really see those films that really dig into the process of songwriting. It's such a personal, creative process. It can be so frustrating. You'll spend hours on a song, get to the end, and you're like, well, this is trash. This film really explores that journey and even explores what it means when songwriters come together, like how Dandelion's music sounded a little different once she started writing with Casey and like all of that. So I think that's kind of what's unique about this film.
Yeah. What do you guys think this film says about the struggle of an artist and that fork in the road, deciding, you know, if and when to hang it up and how difficult that decision can be and sort of what pushes artists to stay with their artistry?
I think there's just unquenchable desire to just achieve and to continue to create, and you can't dull that flame. It's just there, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And it's so heartbreaking. And I've been incredibly, incredibly lucky, incredibly fortunate as a younger actor to have these opportunities and kind of land on my feet and do very well. But I see so many friends and hundreds of young performers. I mean, they're not singer-songwriters, but artists just plodding on and struggling, and it's heartbreakingly beautiful. It's heartbreaking to see the struggle, but it's also beautiful to see that passion gets through and continues and strives and is almost more powerful than all the doubt and everything, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can't really turn off that creativity. And so it's a struggle when you are trying to make a life out of something that is so creative and such a part of your spirit, because sometimes those things aren't aligned, the creative artistic desire and, you know, paying your bills. And it's hard. And I think that's one of the beautiful things that this film really explores is that struggle when you do start to feel too old for certain things. And it's like, damn, like I still have to fight for this. Or like I see 12-year-olds making millions of dollars on YouTube. And I'm like, well, what the fuck am I doing? sorry, am I allowed to curse? Sorry.
Yes. No, we're unrated here.
Unrated. Because I have been holding back.
Go for it.
I think that's something that people are going to respond to in this film, is watching this person. Like you can feel how much Dandelion loves it. You can feel how much Casey loves it, loves creating, loves making music. And it doesn't always put food on the table. And as you get older, it's like you need more stability. You got to be able to keep the lights on.
I hear that. Said it so well. Like, you can't turn it off.
No, you can't.
If it's in you,
you cannot turn it off.
And so you either express it, or you
like choking
it'll
on it.
Eat you inside. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's like you're always one job away. And I think that's what's like so frustrating, like pursuing acting, singing, whatever it may be, is that you just need one person, one shot. Like, I just needed Barry Jenkins to just see me and believe in me. And now look at everything else that has happened because of it. But it's like being that close to like one life-changing moment is equally exciting and also frustrating as hell as an artist.
I felt for a second like you were channeling Lady Gaga on the Star Is Born tour, because there was this montage of her from that press tour going, all you need is one, 99 people will say no, but all you need is one person to believe in you.
And then
there's Seth Rogen has said, like, you know, look at Ian McKellen, look at Sir Ian McKellen. Nobody knew who he was till he was about 55 years old. So like, yeah, those are rare cases, but like it can happen. Don't ever give up. Don't ever get up. Thomas, you really want to curse. What are your favorite curse words?
You do not want to know.
I'm so ready.
What is it? I can feel my manager. I can feel him sweat. Right? I feel that.
Let it out, man.
Absolute panic.
Safe space. Hey,
if you keep it in too long, you're going to explode.
Just get it out now, first thing in the morning.
Well, you guys are both killing it, and you have been for many years. I want to touch on a couple other projects for a moment. Kiki, I think did you just finish Old Guard too? Old Guard was a huge hit for Netflix. People were really excited for part two.
Yes.
What can you tease it for us?
I wish that I could. We did shoot it, and that
is happening.
That's all that my pay grade knows about the Old Guard too.
Well, what have you enjoyed most about like reteaming with Charlize?
I mean, I love her. I respect her so much. Just like, I mean, that's such a badass woman. She's such a smart producer, an incredible actor, and being able to work with her and also Uma Thurman this time around was just like mind-blowing. Yes, Uma is in the second one, and I like doing scenes with her. It just to be in a space with two women who have done what they have done for women in action films.
Yeah.
It's so meaningful to just learn from them and just get to sit and watch how they carry themselves, how they prepare. And yeah, so I hope there will be more news about the Old Guard 2 soon.
Is Uma going Kill Bill on us? Is she going full action mode in this?
I can't give anything away, but I mean, if Uma Thurman is in the Old Guard 2, she's probably kicking
some ass.
You can
draw your own conclusions. you're in Girls 5 Ever, season 3.
I am, yeah.
Yeah.
I am.
Yeah.
It's just really good fun. Worked with some incredible women on that. It was amazing. It's something very, very new for me. I've never done comedy. I've still not seen my episodes. So I'm honestly petrified. Mm-hmm. But Paula Bell assures me that I did well. So that's good enough for me. But it was amazing. And I'm in the middle of doing Tell Me Lies, season 2. Okay. So I'm in the middle of filming that right now in Atlanta. So it's all good fun. And we have a film coming out. It's called Dandelion.
Yes. Well, congrats again. Premiering at South By this weekend. Guys, so great to talk to you once again, and give it up for Team Dandelion.